Well, good morning, everybody. Can you hear me okay? Super. I am so grateful everyone is here. I want to say thank you. What's interesting this year, yo, it is so great to be in front of a live audience. Thank you. Give yourself a hand for being here. This is so great. We're going to be talking a lot about a wonderful things today, but thank you very much for being. What's interesting is we've got about 250 people here in the room, but we have over another 200 or so that are visiting via Zoom. So as a matter of fact, this is the largest client luncheon we have ever had in our 25 years of doing those, and you're here, so thank you very much. And it's basically, and to everybody, like wave, turn around and wave at these cameras to all the Zoomers that are in the group, right? Okay, all of you people. So the important thing here is technology has allowed us to scale that which we do to the point that not only are there 250 people here in the room, but the 250 that are out on Zoom. And it actually gives us the reach so that we're now in 46 different states. We've got clients in 46 different states that we're able to help and work with. And that's a wonderful thing. So thank you for joining us. I want to do just a little housekeeping real quick. One of the key things that's important is for those of you who need them, the restrooms are out that way. That's always an important thing to talk about. And what I want to make sure that we're seeing is that if you have a cell phone, if you have a cell phone or smartphone or anything like that, here I am. But Layla's going to get up here in about 10 minutes and go through a bunch of important tax and legislative updates. Then we have Dr. Kevin Elko will be joining us. Layla will tell you more about him, but he is a world-renowned speaker. You're going to find it very, very enjoyable. And then I'm going to come back and talk about markets, portfolios, do some updates, and then we'll do closing and survey. Now, let's talk about the presentation here itself. For all of those of you who are on Zoom, you have the ability to go and download. If you download, it goes luncheon.pencewealthmanagement.com. You can download the program. Now, for all of you that are here, the program is on your table, and you can pull that out and look at it, because the most important thing that any of us are going to do, so those who are Zoom are able to get to this digitally, but for those of you who are here, is you're going to find there are survey sheets, and I need your help. Please help me out here. So as a matter of fact, you can start filling these out right now. Those of you who are current clients, make sure that you fill out the pink one, right? It talks about anything that we can get you extra information on today, things that you're interested in. And those of you who are guests, and we've got a fair number of guests here with us, and those who are on Zoom, if you're just a client or a prospect or a guest of someone, make sure that you do the digital version and fill out the survey and send in. That's important because it helps us get to know you a little bit better, and it helps us help you should you want that in the future. So please make sure today, as we're talking through various topics and things, if you see something that's of interest, mark that off on the survey. Now, the other thing for those who are on Zoom in the audience, you get the ability to, there's a link that we have sent you ahead of time that you can go to link on to get to the survey. You can get the program. And if for some of you who are having trouble with any of that or tuned in and have it, you can just, we've got people at the office, right? So you can call 949-660-8777, 949-660-8777. And they're there to help you if you need any further help doing that. And by the way, for those of you who are remote, if you send in the survey, you enter a drawing for a $25 Amazon gift card. And I think we're giving away 10 of those, aren't we? Something like that, Layla? Yeah. So Layla controls the budget, so I got to always ask her, right? That's a husband and wife deal. And so We've got basically 10 chances to win that, so you can get an Amazon gift card. But importantly, please fill out the survey and get it in. And then you'll also get a link before and after to make sure that you can do that. Now, another thing, this is for all of you. Big news flash here. We have updated the Pence Wealth Management app. And I know that many of you use the app to get onto your account view, take a look at your accounts. You have your mobile device. You're able to get on and do that. I think I have mine here somewhere like this. You know, and so consequently, we've updated the app. And all you have to do is go on to either Android or iPhone and search Pence Wealth. So please download the app. If you have problems with that, give us a call at the office. And for those of you that are here today during the luncheon, if you're having trouble with it, just grab one of the team members and every year, because I get to introduce my wife, and she never quite knows what I'm going to say. So for the week prior to the luncheon, there's this back and forth teasing as to whether or not I'm going to disclose anything that is incriminating. The fact of the matter is I'm not. But the point of the matter is that it really is my distinct pleasure to introduce to you my wife, Laila. Now, all of you know Laila, all of you have seen Laila, but some of you may not know all of the wonderful things that she's been up to. Now, during, you know, since we've all got been kind of apart here for a little while, there's been a lot of things happening. And one of those things is that she was named to the Barron's Hall of Fame for investment advisors. Give her a big hand on that. Now, that's because she's been on one of the top list of financial advisors in the nation every year for over 10 consecutive years. And just last year, she was named number 14 woman in the nation, right? She's number 14 woman in the nation. She's number 34 of all of the independent advisors in the nation. Guys, there's about 450,000 investment advisors in this nation, okay? There's several hundred thousand independent advisors. So the point is she's number four, so I'm kind of proud of her. But the big one is, there's more. Just hold on. She's always so anxious. But this most recent year, for the fourth consecutive time, Laila has been named by Forbes magazine the number one financial advisor in all of Southern California. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome to the stage my wife, Laila Pence.
There we go. Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much, Dryden, for this wonderful introduction. He teases me a lot, but I always say I married well, don't you think? All right. All right. But this is a very special luncheon for us. This is our 25th year of doing these luncheons, 25 years in a row. Back to 1997. And so what I want to do is I want to take you a little bit through memory lane, kind of remind you some of the good things and some of the bad things that happened the last 25 years, because a lot has happened. So let me get started with that. Okay, well, first of all, you know, we have a war right now, but we've actually lived through four major wars. We had 9/11, we had Afghanistan, Iraq, and of course, we're living through the Ukraine war right now. And we had 18 different corrections. Let me just see here. I think. Federal Reserve, Greenspan, Bernanke, Yellen, Jerome Powell actually raised interest rates. Because right now we're going through this cycle and people say, oh my gosh, you know, it's dramatic, and Dryden's certainly going to talk a lot about that later. But we've had them before. And we've actually lived through five different presidents. Okay, Democrats, Republicans, doesn't matter. Lots of policy changes. And during that time, we've had, even with all these things, the S&P 500 for the last 25 years has gone up almost 450%. That means if you had $1 million, you'd have had 4.5 million today, the last 25 years. Now, it doesn't go straight up, right? There's a lot of zigzags. And you can see the gray area is recessions. Markets definitely do go down in recessions. And if you look at the NASDAQ has done even more, but it's a lot more volatile, right? It's actually gone up almost 800%. That means if you had $1 million, you'd have almost $8 million today. Okay, but that happened all through the time where we've had 18 corrections. In the last 25 years, we had 18 major corrections. That means the market went down more than 10%, 18 times, the S&P 500. And we also had three recessions, three major recessions, the dot-com, the housing crisis, and COVID. And of course, the question mark, whether we're going to have one this year or next year. Again, Dryden's going to talk about that. So the fact of the matter is, over the last 25 years, we've had 18 corrections, three recessions. So there's almost every year, there's been a few years we've actually had the market go up straight, and that kind of think people start thinking this is always going to be that way. But you really cannot have returns in the market if you don't have downturns. It is part of the market. And we're going to talk quite a bit about that when Dryden comes up to speak. But I just wanted to kind of give you a little bit, you know, of a look back what has happened. In those 25 years, we've had these luncheons every year, and we stood up. They've gotten bigger, certainly. I remember back then, if you think of, there was just me and Lana is the blonde, and Donna. And then we had, Lana was actually dark haired at that time. Okay. But we've certainly grown a lot since then. But during those 25 years, we also had a lot of major inventions. A lot of major inventions. These are things that we live with now that we wonder, how did we ever live without? Right? I mean, do you remember? Now we have Wi-Fi. Back then we had dial-up. Remember, you had to dial up to get into the internet, right? And then Google. My gosh, how can we live without Google? We search everything, right? And I love the GPS. I mean, I remember we used to have the Thomas Guide. I used to have a Thomas Guide. I used to look up how to get somewhere. Now I just go, take me to the Marriott Irvine. And the car takes me, right? And YouTube and Facebook and Tesla. I mean, electric cars, you know, who thought an electric car would actually take us somewhere? They were so slow and had no power. Now, I see more Teslas in Orange County than I see other cars, including myself, mine, right? It's a big change. And it's all these changes, all these inventions that really drive growth in the markets. But the biggest one, in my opinion, is the iPhone. 25 years ago, and then now we have the smartphones. The smartphones have more computing power in your smartphone today that you hold than what it took to take the moon, to take the man to the moon. That's how powerful these phones are. And it's what really drives the markets. Because, you know, I get clients and I get people saying, you know, wow, things are not ever going to be as good as they were. But they are. And again, Dryden's going to talk a lot about that because there's more inventions coming. There's more things coming. I won't steal his thunder. I'm going to let him talk about it. Right. Well, you know, our firm has certainly grown. This is a picture of our team. Okay. And for those of you who are here from Pence, can I have you stand up? We can give, here they are. Some of them are here. have grown into this team, into this firm because of all of you. Back 25 years ago, we maybe had less than 100 people here. Now, like Dryden says, we have well over 450 people watching us today. And our team, we are really proud of our team. We are actually ranked in the top 100 by Barron's as private wealth teams. Out of all the teams in the United States, we're in the top 100. And we thank you all for doing that for us. All right, so enough of memory lane and what happened last 25 years. Let me now talk to you about what you really came for, which is planning and tax limits and all those wonderful things. So I'm going to just go over some of the changes this year that regarding the tax limits that have changed. So the first one is the 401k contributions. They haven't gone up in a while, but this year is actually gone up for people age under 50. You can contribute $20,500. And if you are over 50, there's a catch-up provision of $6,500. So you can contribute $27,000 to your 401k or your Roth 401k. Most companies now have a Roth 401k, which, as many of you know, I'm a big proponent of Roth. And we think for most situations, this is a good option. And certainly now you can contribute as much as $27,000 a year and have the money grow tax-free and take it out tax-free. Profit sharing contributions have gone up from $58,000 to $61,000. That also applies to SEP IRAs. So that's a big jump. The annual gift tax exclusion has gone up from $15,000 to $16,000. So this is how much you can give. Any one person can give another, okay, without having to file a gift tax return. And if there's two of you, you can give $32,000 a year now. That's gone up from $30,000 a year. But the big one is the estate tax limits. Now, that's up to over $12 million. You can give that money while you're alive, or you can leave it to your heirs later on and not have any estate tax due. Now, if there's two of you, you can give $24 million. 12 million times two is 24 million. And those numbers are pretty gigantic. And you could do that while you're alive now, because here's the thing, if you have a large estate, you might consider that, because these limits are only gonna go up until the end of 2025. Okay, this bill was passed 10 years ago. At 2025, those limits are supposed to go back to actually change the laws there, whether they're going to, whatever movement's going to happen. But right now, that's how it stands. So they have to do something to change it, to keep it this way, or maybe have some sort of limit. So you have about 3.5 years, we think, may not be as much, because certainly Congress can change that law anytime they want. But if it doesn't, that's a number of years are left to do any estate tax planning. Now, many of you know that we have a SECURE Act. The SECURE Act passed last December 2019, SECURE Act 1. That made a lot of changes. It actually passed it in December. I'm going to go over what the act said before I tell you about what's proposed. So what SECURE Act 1 did, it basically delayed your RMD, your required minimum distribution. As you know, if you have retirement plans, pensions, you know, IRAs, you get to a point, the government says you can tax deferred your money, but at some point in time, they want the taxes. And you must take it, and you must, and there's a required minimum distribution amount that you must take. It used to be 70 and a half. Now you can wait till 72 to begin those required minimum distributions. And then they go up from here. And if you don't take them, the penalty is 50%. Right? So a very, very high penalty. So the act actually delayed when you have to start. And also, number two, allowed IRA contributions indefinitely. Before, if you were working past age 70, and many people have, whether sometimes they do because they need to, sometimes because they want to. But if you have self-employment income past age 70, you now can contribute into an IRA or a Roth IRA for as long as you're working. So before, at age 70, you were stopped. You cannot, even if you're working. But then number three is one that kind of hurt the beneficiaries. Because before that, number three says mandated non-spouse beneficiaries of IRA accounts to complete distributions within 10 years. So before Secure Act 1, a beneficiary would be able to receive their IRA and then take it out over their life expectancy. But now, because they gave benefits to the people who are actually retiring, they had to take the tax money from the beneficiaries. So the beneficiaries now, they only have 10 years to take the money out. They're not required to have any payments every year, but they have 10 years to take it out. So if you have a large IRA and you leave that money to your beneficiaries, they're going to be hit with a big tax bill. And this is why it's, we always think about maybe doing some Roth conversions along the way. Okay, so now that we know the act that we have, I want to tell you about the act that's proposed. Okay, so there's a Secure Act 2.0 that is proposed, but it actually already passed Congress, passed the House on March 29th by the biggest bipartisan vote I have seen. 414 congressmen voted yes, and only 5 voted no. So there's a very, very high likelihood this bill is going to pass. Okay, so what I'm going to cover, what's going to happen is they're going to actually, the House has passed it. The Senate is right now deliberating the bill. And once they pass their version, then it goes to reconciliation. And then we have a bill. So I actually got the pleasure of talking to a congressman that's in the Finance Committee last night to ask him about that, because he's involved with that. And he says that they're most likely going to pass it in the lame duck session of Congress, which means sometime in November or December. But the, you know, so I got it firsthand that we're actually going to have a bill. It definitely has some major changes I want to go over. First one is going to delay again your required minimum distribution, the age you have to take it out. So next year, it would be delayed to age 73. And then after that, it would delay to 74 and 75. So within, by 2032 or 33, it would be 75. Actually, the congressman last night told me that this is the one area that they're still deciding what ages to use. But they are going to do it to age 75. They just don't know what when they will do it. But that's a good thing. So if you're age 50 right now, you have 25 years to take your money out. You can grow your money in your retirement accounts for 25 more years, because you could probably, you'll be able to wait until 75 to take money out. They also did something else. They actually are changing any catch-up provisions that you get to make. They're going to make them where they are Roth contributions. So for people who are age 50 and over, their $6,500 now will be a Roth contribution, so it will not be deductible. And then they added another one from age 62 to 64. That contribution will actually be increased to $10,000. But again, it has to be a Roth contribution, which in my opinion is a good thing, not a bad thing, but it's their way of getting tax dollars still and giving, allowing people to put more money away, but then they're not deductible any longer. Also, in this bill, they're going to index everything to inflation, which, you know, since we have inflation, I guess this is one positive thing for inflation, is that they will index the contribution limits to inflation, including IRA contribution, which they haven't changed in a long time. IRA contributions have been $6,000 for under 50 and $7,000 over 50 for years. So this bill will automatically index these contribution limits, allow them to go up every year as by the amount of inflation, so that they keep up with the cost of living. So those things appear that are going to pass. Now, the whole idea of this act is they really, really want people to put money away for retirement. And so they're changing it where it's going to be automatically auto-enrollment. If you work for a company, okay, and by the way, in California here, companies that have 6 employees or more must now have retirement plan. That changed last year. So you no longer don't have a retirement plan, but this bill would automatically have a 3% auto enrollment for all employees. And that could be, depending on the plan, 401k, simple IRA, 403b, they will actually, now you can opt out, but they really want to have it automatically. So people, forcing people, encouraging people to put money away, because we're all living longer and we're going to need more money in retirement. And one of the best ways to have money is in your retirement plan. And then right now they allow Roth contributions in 401k, but they never allowed it into SEP IRAs or simple IRAs. So this bill would allow Roth contribution in those plans as well. So, you know, we cover a lot of these. So many of you know that we, you know, about really through COVID, when COVID hit, we decided to start doing podcasts. And we feel that our podcasts that we do, the market is volatile, we'll do them more often, sometimes once a week, sometimes. But right now we've been doing them every other week or every 2 weeks. But generally we do them once a month. It's our way of communicating with you. We really feel that we spend about 30 minutes, Dryden and I spend about 30 minutes once a month where we go over what's happening with the market. What are we doing? What happened this a lot of time, a lot of effort putting these, we feel that that's a much better way to communicate with you versus emails. You know, people get so many emails now. You can't open them all. But with podcasts, you can just listen this 30 minutes. If you miss listening to it, you can certainly, we always have it on our website thereafter, so you can listen to it on your own. But you do have to register. If you are listening to it live, you do have to register for the podcast to actually listen in. So our next one is August 25th. And depending when this law changes, probably like I heard yesterday, probably won't change till November. We will have a whole session about it. And we'll also, in this case, we'll actually might send out an email as well, letting you know about the changes. But please listen into our podcast. You're going to find them informative and keep up to date with what we're doing. All right. So I have 10 actions here that I want to go over, some things that you might consider doing before the end of the year. First one is to, you know, we have a down market. Okay. We have a bear market. We can't deny that. We have a down market, but let's get some benefits of it here. Okay. Let's make some lemonade out of this lemon that we have, right? So it's, if you ever consider doing a Roth conversion, this is the time to do it when the market is low. It's even more beneficial because if your account is lower, then you pay taxes on the lower amount that you want to convert. And then you put it into the Roth, it goes up, market recovers, which we know markets always do. Then when it recovers, it'll grow tax-free. So this is really an optimum time to convert into a Roth and maybe stay within the same tax bracket that you're in. Okay, you can do that. And we can help you decide how much of that when you, if you let us know you're interested in that. Number two, consider real estate interval funds. Okay, so in the past, we used to have what we call real estate REITs, real estate investment trusts, where they were fine, except that we always were in the mercy of the sponsor when to sell. They were not liquid, and people did not like the fact that they were not liquid, and we didn't know when they were liquidated. So today, there's what we call interval funds. These real estate interval funds are somewhat more liquid, actually, usually every 3 months, okay, where you can liquidate them because they're actually an ongoing fund. They never actually sell because it's a whole big portfolio. It's a portfolio that invests with private equity real estate. So you're a part owner of a large, large portfolio of real estate all over the country, multiple type of portfolio assets, multiple type of investments. We could choose which one you're more comfortable with. And they're paying very good cash flow right now. Many of them are paying over 5% in income and very much also a very large percentage of that income is tax sheltered because you have the real estate benefits, you have the depreciation, the interest expense. So most of them are about 60 or 70% tax shelter. So you get good cash flow. And of course, investment real estate could do well with inflation because they're able to raise rents and that determines the income. And so if we're looking for a place to put some money in and you think inflation is going to be with us, you might want to consider that. If you're interested in any of that, again, just in your survey sheets, mark that off and we'll talk to you about it. Long-term care. I don't know about you. I'm not getting older, but a lot of us are. Yeah. And it really, long-term care is the biggest risk in retirement. It is costly. And so there's many ways to fund that risk if you do it right and if you do it early. Actually turns into long-term care benefits if you need it for long-term care. Because at the end of the day, we're either going to die or we're going to have long-term care. This is it, right? So you're going to benefit from this plan because it's going to pay off one way or the other. There's another plan, which is a single pay. Well, when you may want to just pay one time, because a lot of my clients don't really like to pay ongoing premiums. It still has some life insurance, but you can just pay one time and then it provides long-term care. And then there's also long-term care annuities. If you have an annuity that you've bought for a long time and you don't really need the income, and even if you need the income, you go, oh my gosh, I'm going to take the income. I'm going to have to pay taxes on all that income because you never pay taxes on it. So people kind of have these annuities and they keep them there. Well, now there's a way you can exchange them on a tax-free basis into a long-term care annuity. And it usually gives you about three times what the value is in long-term care benefits. But the beauty of it is the benefits when you receive them would be tax-free. So now you're turning taxable income into tax-free long-term care benefits if you have one of those. So it's a very good thing to consider or look at if you're in that position. Number four, if you like to give assets to charity, we always recommend don't give cash. If you have appreciated assets, consider giving appreciated assets and consider doing it in a donor advised fund. This is a fund where you get to put the stock in there, whatever you have is appreciated. You get the tax deduction based on the market value of the stock. You save paying taxes on the capital gains. You have that whole value of that stock in this fund. You get to give it to whomever you want, whenever you want, and as much as you want, or as long as you want. You don't have to give it all away to the charity now. You can have it in this fund, get the tax deduction, and then it's a really, really good tool to give away money to charity and also save taxes at the same time. Number five, if you're at that age where you have required minimum distributions, then the government does allow you to give as much as $100,000 of your required minimum distributions directly to charity. And that is better than getting the money and giving to charity, because when you give it directly from your required minimum, it does not affect your adjusted gross income. Because if it's income first and you give it as a charity, then your adjusted gross income, you know, which determines a lot of your deduction, is increased. So if you'd like to give to charities, then all you have to do is call us, or call your advisor and say, hey, I have this charity that I would like to give to. Then we send a check to you, made out to the charity, and then you get to give it to your charity when you know, and have that benefit. So it's a good way. They are talking about increasing that, by the way. We don't know if they will or not, but right now it's $100,000 maximum a year. Okay, I talked about gifting, you know, the limits went up to $16,000. Well, a 529 plan, if you have children or grandchildren, it's the best gift you can ever give them is a 529 plan. And today, if you're a single taxpayer, you can pre-fund 5 years in advance. So you can take $80,000, put it in one of these 529 plans, have it grow completely tax-free. And as long as that money is used for college costs, including tuition, rent. It's really good because this year, my daughter actually has to move out. She decided to want to move out of the dorm and into an apartment with her roommate, and the rents are high. And I get to use her 529 plan for that. So it's a big benefit. If you're a couple, you can fund $160,000 all one time into a 529 plan. And this is, you know, we talked about a down market. Thing you can ever do for them. All right, number seven, structured products. Now, structured products are become very popular when interest rates go up, okay? They are products that use options to reduce risk or have more income, okay? They're a little bit complicated. I'm not gonna spend a lot of time today, but they have names like buffer, where, you know, I don't mind giving up the upside of the market, but if the market goes down by 10%, I don't want to lose that 10%, or I don't want to lose 20% of my money. And instead of getting 100% of the market upside, I'll take 80% of the market upside. There's these products. There are those are called structural products. And there's also ones where they actually pay cash flow, where they pay income. And again, they become popular as interest rate goes up. When interest rates are low, they really don't make sense. They don't pay enough. But now the interest rates is going up, structured products are certainly popular, and we can tell you all about that if you're interested. Number eight, you know, I talked about the Secure Act 1, where you now have only 10 years to take your money out from your IRA. Well, if you have a big IRA, you might consider looking at your beneficiaries again and increasing the number of beneficiaries to give this money to, because this is going to be taxed for each beneficiary's tax rate. So maybe instead of just your two sons or your daughter, you might want to include your grandchildren, because that spreads the tax over many, many more people when these distributions are made. So you really need to be reviewing your beneficiary designations and also your trust. Number nine, if you, we really think corporate trustee saves so many families, keeps them together. You know, when you name, if you have a larger estate and you name an individual trustee, it is a daunting job. I have, unfortunately, I've had many clients pass away, and I've had dealt with many successor trustees, and it is really, it creates so much friction between the family members. It doesn't ensure that you are getting your benefits or your trust distributed exactly like you want. So there is corporate trustees, there is trust companies that's all they do for a living. They become you when something happens to you. They also become you while you're alive, if you get to the point where you can't handle your affairs and you don't want your children doing that. You name a trust company, and then they get the assets, they move them to the right trust, and then they can continue to be trustees, or they can then give them to your kids to handle the money for them. Last but not least is to definitely review your life insurance and your annuity policies. Okay, now, so I've covered a lot of things here, and I really, really want you to take out your surveys and mark if anything I said that was interesting or you're interested in anything, and make sure you fill this out. But those also will be your raffle tickets at the end of the day. Okay, at the end of Dryden's presentation, we're gonna want to pick those up. So fill this in. And if you're a guest, it's yellow. If you're a client, it is pink. And if you are online, you, again, like Dryden says, you should have already gotten the link, and you'll get the link again at the end of the session. All right, now I have the absolute pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Kevin Alcom. I am really excited to introduce where he received two master's degrees and a doctorate and was later inducted into West Virginia University Hall of Fame. He went on to intern at the United States Olympic Committee in Colorado Springs. He was consulted with the Steelers, Cowboys, Eagles, Dolphins, and the Saints. Dr. Alcom also worked with seven BCS national champs, including Miami, LSU, Alabama, Florida State. He's a man after my own heart, because you know, if anybody knows me, I love sports, and he gets to deal with all these sports people. But he's an amazing speaker. We've heard him speak many times. He's going to talk about resiliency, and I am just so excited to have him here speak to all of you. So please help me welcome Dr. Kevin Alcom.
I bet you can hear me now. They already told you I'm from West Virginia. I got to figure stuff out. So I have to say this every time I speak. All you have to do to get in the West Virginia Hall of Fame is have your teeth. That's all you have to do. I've spoken in Kentucky. They get all kind of upset about that. We are the number one state in the country for having less teeth than anybody else. So y'all got to get excited about that. I got a full set and they get happy. I love me the Pences a lot. I love coming out here. I've been out in California all week. I speak in New York City tomorrow, and I'm friends with these guys. I love them. I guess y'all love them too. I have an accent. I'm from the South. So I hope we get along okay. After she gave me that beautiful introduction, I hope these people even understand me as I get going. I'm from West Virginia. I have worked with different teams. I do most of my work with Alabama football now. So I doubt if I have any Crimson Tide in the house. I work with Coach Saban. And that guy's not a pleasant fella. I'll go in, I'll say, Coach, what do you want me to say to the team? And I usually get something back like this. Well, how in the blank do I know? If I knew what the blank got to say, I would have said it. Roll Tide. So I get into working with attitude. We're going to talk about that. That's what my doctorate's in. I left here. I worked for the Olympic Committee. I left here and went to work for the International Olympic Committee. I was living in Greece. Can I tell you guys what I figured out in Greece? I love being American. Boy, that hit me pretty good over there. Their motto is Yankee, go home and take me with you. So I left Greece and moved to Pittsburgh to work for the Pittsburgh Steelers. That's where that thing started. I came in with Bill Cowher, the head coach. I said, Coach, what you want me to do for the team? He goes, I don't know if you ever see him on TV. His chin sticks out. He's spitting all over the place. He said, you're going to help me select athletes here based on attitude. I said, well, Coach, what does that mean? He said, our athletes here don't know the meaning of the word fear. I said, they don't know the meaning of most words. I had a Steeler once go, Doc, I got a new dog. I said, what did you get? He said, a Labor Day receiver. Ooh, Dryden Pence come out. I was excited about that one. The next he said was overcoming adversity. That's pretty good. You know what I'm going to teach you to do today? How to talk to you. Yeah, I'm going to teach you how to talk to you. I'm going to teach you. Talking to me, you know, do I listen to me or do I talk to me? And I've got different degrees. I got one in gerontology, aging, addictions, different things, but it all comes down to how you talk to you. Do me a favor. Look at somebody at your table and tell them today he's going to teach us how to talk to ourselves. Come on, help me out. Come on. I didn't come all this way to do it by myself. Tell he's going to teach us how to talk to ourselves. You have 70, we just have a book out called Believing is Seeing. You know, you have 70 to 90,000 thoughts a day and 80% of them are negative. Well, how are you going to be happy if you got that conversation going on? How are you going to be anything but miserable? Here's a little phrase I start telling myself. You want things to change, then you have to change. You want things to be different, you have to be different. If you want the world to have peace, wouldn't it start that you have it first? I'm fired up today. You better get ready. So it comes down to talking to yourself. And this is a simple talk. I'm from West Virginia. We're not known for rocket science. We're known for moonshine. This will be simple. I'm going to have you just say three things by the time we're done that you can go to the next level. Be resilient. Keep coming back from a setback. Keep on going forward. What's behind it all? Now, listen to this phrase before we get started. I'm going to talk about be happy, how to be resilient. I'll define those things, but let's talk about this. You're not wired to be happy. You're not even wired to be successful. You're wired to be safe. What happens is our minds are wired like every other part of our body. Your kidneys are supposed to keep you alive. Your liver is supposed to keep you alive. So our brains are often looking for bad and Velcro. You're not negative. Your spouse isn't negative. We all are. Our brains are Velcro for bad. It's looking all the time because it wants to protect us. So we're often looking for the bad things until we program the brain. So that's what we're going to get into today. You know, and here's the other thing. Your brain's very plastic. They have water bottle up here. This is plastic. Now, what's it mean? If I squeeze it, it changes. So we've hit two things. Your brain is naturally Velcro for bad until we change it. And it changes all the time. I'm on a cruise with my sister and her two kids. I've got my two kids. And her son says something 5,000 times a day on that cruise. For sure. For sure. For sure, for sure, for sure. I almost jumped off the boat. For sure, I can't take it anymore. For sure, for sure. I about lost my mind. I came home from that cruising for 2 weeks. I was walking around, for sure, for sure, for sure, for sure. Your mind's very plastic. So I've got to shape it and I've got to go to the next level. And to shape it. Now, let's talk about this first thing. This talk, let's first make a decision. Make a decision to be happy. You know why? If you aren't happy, you're a burden to somebody, probably somebody you're sitting with. Right now, don't point to your husband. This man comes home and his wife's in a beautiful black suit, luggage all around her. He said, "What's going on?" She goes, "I'm leaving you." He said, "This is all of a sudden." She said, "I can't take anymore." He says, "There's someone else?" She said, "There just has to be." This woman went to her husband and said, "Honey, what would you do if I hit on the lottery?" He said, "I'd take my half. I'd leave." She said, "That's what I thought. Here's your $10. You keep in touch." Tell somebody at your table, "I am going to enjoy my life." Come on, tell them. Come on, look at them and tell them, "I'm going to enjoy my life." It's about time. Hey, can I challenge you? Stop complaining. Stop complaining. You complain on a regular basis, your blood pressure raises. Secondhand complaining, new concept. You listen to somebody else complaining, your blood pressure goes higher than theirs. I'm not even complaining. I'm just listening to you. Your cortisol levels, which cause inflation, go crazy in your body. You have impaired cognitive functioning. I can't even think as well because I'm listening to you complain. I have a higher chance of getting sick because I'm listening to you complain. I thought about this voice message. "Hello, you got in contact with Kevin." That's my name. "And I'm not in it this time. And I've been planning some changes in my life. And if I don't call you back, you're probably one of those changes." If we're going to enjoy our life, there's a way you can think to enjoy your life. I can't change. I love what I just heard in the presentation. I can't change the markets. I can't change my in-laws. I can't change things around me, but I can change the way I think. Let's talk about in-laws for a minute. I had an Elko, that's my last name, family reunion in Dallas 2 months ago. I walked in there. I thought it was the bar scene from Star Wars. And every one of you has some crazy family members. If you're sitting there right now thinking, "That's funny, I don't," do you know why you're thinking that? You're the crazy one. I'm going to say something to you right now. I want to see if you agree with this. We have a big epidemic today. And I was just talking to Dryden about it. Want to tell you the big epidemic? Offended. Everybody's touchy. Everybody's touchy. How can I be happy if I'm walking around so touchy? And it's a decision not to be so. If you agree with me that the world's a little bit too touchy right now, clap one time. Come on, clap. So look at somebody at your table. Tell them, "Quit being so touchy." Come on, tell them, "Girl, you're too touchy. Y'all too touchy. Everybody's touchy." So when I go into the Elko family reunion, I can't change them, but I can change what I say about them. I can change how I think about them. I'm not going to surrender my peace to that. I just say that's it. My one cousin called me from that group and said, "My dad's an evangelist. He goes around the country talking about hell. I don't believe in hell." I go, "You don't believe in hell?" He said, "No." I go, "Okay, come to the Elko family reunion, stay 3 hours." Y'all fun. How do I think? And the first thing you got to do is declare that you'd like to be happy. That we can get. And the second thing is, how can I have an effective life that matters? Now, listen to this phrase, we set this up, because we're going to go into a little brain chemistry here. Neurons that fire together, wire together. Everybody in the house say that phrase. Say, neurons that fire together. Come on, say it. Wire together. Your mind, if I keep speaking over and over and over, I wire it. And that's what we're going to do. How do we do that? How do I wire my brain that I can be resilient? What does resilient mean? Coming back from a setback. You got to keep coming back, baby. Something happens, I got to keep coming back strong. How do I keep on coming back? And how can I be happy? So here's the first one. Ready? Change your mouth. Change the way you talk. Change the way you speak. Tell somebody at your table, change the way you talk. Come on, tell me, you got to change the way you talk. The way you're talking going to make you miserable. The way you're talking going to make you miserable. So I work in the NFL. Hey, if I'm doing okay so far, clap. And I ask them, tell me the best game you ever had in your life. Article in the Wall Street Journal. You know, happy people talk different. You know, effective people talk different. And I ask them that question because there are all these college players. Tell me the best game you ever had in your life. That joker thinks I want to hear about that game. I don't care about that game. I want to hear the first word that comes out of his mouth. If he says two words, I dismiss him. I and me. Unhappy people say I and me all the time. Well, why is this financial? Why is Pence so successful? Because it's not about I and me. I know them. It's how do I serve the people? How do I be blessing the people? Oh, I'm cooking at about 450 today. Do you know what happy people, effective people, you know the word they say all the time? Anybody want to take a guess? You said it, ma'am. Say it again. We came together. We focused. We prayed. We cared. When they start saying we, I get up. I start doing a little dance. I start doing my little rumble when they do that we thing. I can still drop it like it's hot. I can't pick it up anymore. Come on, whole house one time. Say the word we. Come on. We came together. We strong. Here's the next. Quit talking about what you don't want. Worry's praying for what you don't want. Quit talking about worry is worshiping the problem. Quit talking about what you do want. This guy's up in his bedroom, hears some rustling down the kitchen, comes down, there's a man down there. He says, excuse me, are you stealing my stuff? Are you a robber? Are you a burglar? Yeah, I'm taking all your stuff. He says, would you wait a minute? I'd like to introduce you to my wife. She's been telling me you're going to come for 35 years. You two should meet. Be careful. See, this guy has a pharmacy, and he takes a break. Young clerk comes behind the counter. Man comes in with a bad cough. He looks everywhere for some cough suppressant. He can't find any, so he gives the guy a laxative. Try not to get ahead of me over there. The pharmacist come back after lunch. Did anything happen when I was gone? Guy came in with a bad cough. I looked everywhere for some suppressant. I couldn't find any, so I gave the guy a laxative. Pharmacist, wait a minute. A laxative won't stop somebody from coughing? Young clerk said, sure it will. Look at that guy standing over there. He's trying real hard not to cough. If you didn't get that, come over to Pence table. They'll explain it to you later. What I'm trying to say with that one is, if you think about what you don't want, you're going to get it. It could get messy. Here's the third one. Ready? Do you understand resiliency coming back, a smile on your face, forgiveness, hope, grit? It's all a choice. It's not a feeling. I work at the NFL. They're making $10 million a year. I'm not feeling it. You're not feeling it? Attitude's a choice. Loving somebody is a choice. Being kind is a choice. Not a feeling. I don't understand how feelings are driving everything all of a sudden. I'm going to choose to put a smile. I'm going to choose to forgive. I'm going to choose to be kind. I don't always feel like it, but it's a choice. Start saying this a lot. Say the word we, everybody. Come on, say it again. And start saying this phrase. I decided. Come on, say I decided. You can decide right now. I decide to smile. I decide to forgive. It's not a feeling. Quit letting your feelings drive it. So first, change the way you speak. Number two, change the way that you talk to you. Paul Tuff does this. So we teach something called tools for the mind. We teach them how to have private speeches, to control themselves. Have you ever thought about what you think about? Have you ever thought about the kind of speeches you have with you all day long? What if you changed them on purpose? You change your life. Nothing changed until you change that. And if I could change the way that I'd interact with me in those little private conversations on purpose, Nelson Mandela walked out of prison. He got a scowl on his face. Bill Clinton saw it. What were you mad about? 27 years you're in jail. You should be happy. Events don't make you miserable. Events don't make you quit. Events don't make you pout. Events don't make you have a grudge. The way that you decide to think about those things. And I can change that. And some of y'all are getting this. And you all got to get it. I love how we just went over the technology. But don't you agree that we need a technology of how we think? An attitude? How do we do it? So Nelson Mandela walks out of prison, gets a scowl on his face. Bill Clinton saw it. What were you mad about? 27 years you're in jail. You should be happy. He's mad. He's offended. Watch why. He said, the same people celebrating my release put me in there. There's the event. I want you to watch close what he did next, because what I'm trying to teach you today. He stood aside like he was two people. That's it. That's what I'm trying to teach you. He stood aside like he was two people, and he talked to himself. He went, Nelson, when you were in prison, you were free. Now you're free. Don't put yourself in prison. There it is. I want you to have those. Everybody in the house, say, I said to myself. Come on, say it. There's two people there. Look, quit getting offended and get out of self-pity. Get out of there. You ever see this movie Pitch Perfect 2? These four girls singing a major university, a big contest. They got thrown off the stage because they sung so bad. The one girl from America, she goes, this is the worst thing ever happened to me. The other girl was from a third world country. She said, I had diarrhea once for 7 years. Whew. Everybody in the house, say this out loud. Say, if I lost everything I have today. Come on, say it. And all I get back tomorrow is what I had today. Come on. Tomorrow would be the best day of my life. Was that right or wrong? Did y'all agree with that? Do you agree with that one? It'd be the best day. We got to get out of offended. We got to get out of self-pity. And the way to do is how you think. Dr. James Gills has done more eye surgeries than anybody in the world, most in third world countries. 40 marathons, 18 Bostons. That means he did 8 back-to-back triathlons. He ran 26-point miles on Monday, did on Tuesday 6 times. He has done more eye surgery, humanitarian of the year, John Hopkins, alumni of the year, Duke. Dr. Gills, how? He said, most people just listen to themselves. I talk to me. Tell somebody at your table, look at them and tell them, you have to talk to you. Come on, tell them, you have to talk to you. You have to do it. Now, let me show you something. They asked me, do you have PowerPoint? Yeah, here's my PowerPoint. It's called the West Virginia PowerPoint. See this? That's it. My friend was just trying to show you what's coming ahead. She had a question mark. I'm going to show you what's coming ahead. Ready? That's the rest of this year. This chair. It's going to go good. Here's how most people do their life. Ready? This is awful. This is terrible. I'm going to go get drunk, see if Walmart needs a greeter. Here's the better way. Isn't that chair having a rough go? You're driving down the road, and you accidentally cut somebody off. And they wind down their window and say to you, go be fruitful. And multiply with yourself. I was in a slow reading group. I mean, fourth grade was the toughest 3 years of my life. I don't know what to do with that. You wind down your window and say, me, you go be fruitful, multiply with yourself. They turned you into them. I was going for a walk around here last night, and some guy almost ran me over. I just said, I will not let his anger become my anger. Say this out loud. In 2023, come on, everybody talk to me. Say it. Come on. I will not let them turn me into them. Years ago, I'm on the sidelines of Pittsburgh Steelers. We're playing the Dallas Cowboys. And this Dallas Cowboy is going to return his punt, and he's riding his horse, and he's spanking his horse, and he's riding this thing up and down our sideline, and he's yeehawing, he's lassoing, but there was no horse. It was Deion Sanders, this kind of crazy guy. So he asked all the Steelers, what sideline do you want to see me return this punt? They said, come our way. He starts riding his horse again and spanking it. He grabbed the punt. He runs right to Pittsburgh. He's running up our sideline with the ball in his hand. He's waving at us with this hand, right? Doing this little kind of goose step thing. We never touched him. I mean, no one laid a finger on him from Pittsburgh. He scored a touchdown. So the next year, I started working for the Cowboys. My first day there, I'm there, and someone's going, "Hey, Dion, you stink. We can't stand you. Get out of Texas." He points to the guy and says, "Come here. Not your sharpest knife in the drawer." So he goes to the guy screaming at him. He goes, "God bless you." The guy said, "What?" He said, "May God bless you." This guy goes, "You didn't have to make it personal." And he walked away. I am not going to let them turn me into them. So let's talk about resiliency first. Coming back. We got to keep coming back. Coming back from a setback. I got a Jewish proverb on my wall. When I fall, who I become will catch me. Here is the research says on being resilient. Go and be a good friend, a better friend to you. Tell somebody you're sitting with, "I'm going to be a better friend to me." Come on, tell somebody, "I'm going to be a better friend to me. I have to be a much better friend to me." We're really not very good to ourselves. Let's talk about that. I've got a degree, one of the gerontologists study of aging. Can I tell you the number one factor in longevity? It's a 49-year study done at Harvard called the George Vaillant 49-year study. It's the AA Serenity Prayer. I pray every morning. Can I tell you my prayer? I did this morning. I go, "Don't let my mind go to something today I can't do anything about. Just don't let me go there. I don't want to let my mind go and spin and go. I can't do nothing about it. Don't let my mind get eaten up, chewed up. I can't do nothing about it." That is the number one factor when you wire your brain with some things I can control, but I say it different. Repeat this after me. Say, "Change the changeable." Come on, say it. Hear you, encourage you. I mean, really encourage you. I'm with the Steelers and this guy blows his knee out. I said, "I'm going to teach you three things." Here comes number one, Chad Scott. And I go, "Chad, how you doing with that knee?" He goes, "I'm chopping down trees. I'm drinking battery acid." Everybody in the house, take your left hand, go like that. Take your right hand, go like this. Come on, chop. If you're chopping a tree and that tree doesn't fall, you cuss that tree out. Keep going. Quit getting frustrated. Quit panicking. Quit losing your mind. I'm going to keep on doing this until it gets done. I got to learn how to finish stuff. Keep on going. In San Francisco, I spoke in San Francisco yesterday. In San Francisco, this little boy is born out of left arm. He wanted to play sport. His mother enrolled him in judo and taught him one move. He mastered the move. Puts him in these tournaments with all these tournaments. Now your championship cross from a brute. Referee goes, the instructor says, "You're going to get that kid killed." The instructor says, "That kid will be fine." The kid goes to the instructor, "You're going to get me killed. You'll be fine." He wins the match. They're driving home. Kid looks at the instructor and says, "Why'd you do that to me? I don't have a left arm." And that guy was a killer today. "And you only taught me one move." The instructor says, but wait a minute now. I told you to master that move. Did you?" Kid goes, "Yes." The instructor said, "Well, there's only one defense for that move, to grab your left arm. That was the only defense for that move." Come on, one more time. Come on, one more time with me. And here's the last one. I want to ask you a question. Ready? Do you have faith in faith? Do you think believing in something matters? So nobody has it anymore. So let me go to the next question. Do you have faith? Is it okay for you to have faith in you? It's not uppity, it's faithity. I can go over and over different people in their lives, and they just chose that. Why not? Wouldn't you be able to get through things if you believed you can get through things? Wouldn't you get through things if you thought, no matter what, I think I've got what it takes to do that? Wouldn't that mean everything? This guy named Frank Szymanski had a test on a civil suit. He's on the stand, and the judge says, "How good are you?" He said, "Judge, please don't ask me that." He said, "Answer it." He said, "I'm the best offensive lineman who's ever played at Notre Dame." Next week, he's back on campus as Coach Frank Leahy. He said, "Did you say you're the best offensive lineman ever played at Notre Dame?" He said, "I did, Coach." "Why did you say that?" He said, "I didn't want to. I was under oath." Do you have faith in you? Why not? Why can't you overcome it? Why can't you face it? Why can't you go higher? I have a friend who lives by me, Lee Ford. You ever hear this country western song? It's by Billy Ray Cyrus. My wife left town with my best friend, and I miss him. Well, Lee's wife leaves town with his best friend in Columbus, Ohio, and he comes to Pittsburgh to live by me. He has a daughter, Emily. She's Down syndrome, says light of his life. Has another child. She goes to Alabama. We go down there a good bit. He gets hit by a car in Pittsburgh. This woman's texting 40 miles an hour. They give him an hour to live, a day to live, a week to live. He's going to be fine. I go, Lee, how'd you do it? I don't know. I saw that we put up, but I just have faith in our economy. I wouldn't come all the way out here if I didn't have faith in the Pence group. I have faith in all of you. I know we talk about our country, but I have faith in all of it. I don't know, and I have faith in me. Go have faith in you. Tell somebody again, I'm going to be a good friend to me. Come on, tell them. I got to be better. Come on, come on. I got to be a good friend to me. And that really means change the changeable, accept the unchangeable, remove the unacceptable, keep chopping, and decide to have faith in you. Now, let's keep on talking about resiliency. I have another book. It's my eighth book coming out in October. I walk in places, people have this phrase tattooed on their arm. I speak it all the time. I had a friend of mine in San Francisco yesterday text me this because he got diagnosed with cancer yesterday. He got diagnosed and sent me this. This is my phrase. I told you what you think causes what you feel. Watch, this is about resiliency. Here comes, ready? So what? Now what? That's my baby. I speak it all the time. I speak it nonstop. I was coaching my daughter all morning, giving her a little so what, now what. She's crying. I said, Claire, we're in so what, now what territory. This is no big thing. Let's talk about so what, now what. There's a lot of things I don't like about getting older. I don't like it you can sneeze and pull a muscle. I like what Billy Crystal said, the comedian. I don't like it that you go to the bathroom in the middle of the night. It's in Morse code. Some young people back there going, I don't know what he's talking about. Everybody know what he's talking about? You hang on, Chachi. Can I tell you guys what I love about getting older? Stupid stuff doesn't matter. If I can't do anything about it, I've got real good at saying, so what? I got real good at so what? I'm one of the best so what people I've ever met. I've learned to ignore some things. Have you? They did research at Stanford on happy people. They took young people, put them on MRI, shot positive imagery at them, their brains fired. Negative imagery, their brains fired. Took happy older people, shot positive imagery at them, their brains fired. Negative imagery, they didn't notice. They didn't even blink. You got to learn to say, so what the stuff? I work for this company called TNT Fireworks, dropping Muscle Shoals, Alabama. I work for everybody in Alabama. And you ever hear Muscle Shoals has got the Swampers? Where's a place like that? And they come to pick me up to go to work for TNT Fireworks. It's in Tampa, Florida, come pick me up. So I go to get on a plane, and the pilot asked me on the tarmac. He says, there's three people on the plane. I got to ask you a question before you get on the plane. Okay. How much do you weigh? I said, why would you ask me that? He said, we need to know how much fuel to put in the plane. I said, fill it up. Tell you exactly how much. So I, you guys are fun. So I sit down on the plane. And this Russian guy taps me on the shoulder. And I couldn't make out what he was asking me. I finally did. He asked me, he goes, do you think everybody told the truth on this plane about their weight? I got off. I said, that's it. I'm out of here. I'm done. But if you stay on life's plane and you hit turbulence and you can't do anything about it, please learn to say, say it again. It's a beautiful, if I. Today, there's magic in it. So what? I don't know what's coming with the markets, but there's stuff you can't do anything about. I don't know what's happened with the future, but I could do something about today. I could be 1-0 today. I could be 1-0 today. Dave Martinez with the Nationals. They won the World Series. They were 19-31. He started saying, be 1-0 today. Get the most out of today. Be where your feet are. So what? I say it all the time. So what? See, because if you keep on saying it's awful and your mind tries to fix something it can't do anything about, now, let's get to now what. I don't know what's happening. Now what? There's a little town called Enterprise, Alabama. They're growing cotton. It's 1910, and the boll weevil wipes them out. You know, our national, really our national mascot should be the boll weevil. It's come. It's going to come to you medically. It's going to come to your relationships. It's going to come to your business. It's going to come to the economy. What do you do with it? If you can't change your mind, you can't change anything. You better have a mind for it. I don't know. The world's going to keep changing. I wish it wasn't, but used to bees don't make honey, baby. They're going to keep changing. What do you do? So they got nothing. Somebody says a brand new crop called the peanut. We got no cotton. We got bare fields. They plant the peanut. They become wealthy from the peanut. If you go to Enterprise, Alabama today, in the middle of the town is a big statue of a bug. It's the only place in the world where insect was honored with a statue. And I was talking to the sheriff's daughter down there. She said they get drunk and steal it now and then, but they bring it back when they're sober. We don't arrest nobody. Don't live in circumstances. Live in vision. Say this phrase. I'm going to get to my last one. The first one's chop. Say, so what, now what? Look, I have another phrase I use. That happened for me. They carried me out of my house June 5th, 2017 in an ambulance. Took me to Cleveland Clinic. Told me I missed dying by 2 minutes. I hope it happens to every one of you. Best thing ever happened to me. That didn't happen to me. That happened for me. Find meaning in it. Can I show you how it happened for me? There's a baseball pitcher for the New York Mets. Tug McGraw came out with this phrase. You got to believe. They trade him to the Phillies. They interview him in Philadelphia and ask him, what do you like better, AstroTurf or grass? He says, I don't know. I've never smoked AstroTurf. His son's a country western singer. His name's Tim McGraw. That baseball pitcher passed away, and a song came out of the death of a country western singer. That's my dad. About a guy who had a bad x-ray, went to his friend and said, it's over. What you do when you realize? He said, I went skydiving. I went Rocky Mountain climbing. 2.7 seconds on a bull named Fu Manchu. Loved deeper, spoke sweeter. I gave forgiveness I've been denying. I hope you get the chance to live like you're dying. So what, now what? It happens for me. Last one. I wonder why this Pence group's so successful, but I think I got an idea. I think I got a good idea. During World War II, the biggest challenge was keep your ammunition dry. And I tell people, give your emotions directions. And this woman had two sons in the military. And it bothered her that maybe her sons could not protect herself. So she gave her feelings directions. This is one of my new phrases. And she went to her boss and said, I have an idea to keep ammunition dry. He didn't get it. But she kept. It's not about me, what I get, it's about being a blessing. That's my last phrase. I'm not looking for blessings to come to my life. I'm looking to be a blessing in somebody's life. So she took the idea on how to keep ammunition dry, gave her feelings directions to Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And he loved it, and it's called duct tape. I work with people, and they go, you know what? I worked with a guy one time. He says, you know, my mother worked double shifts as a single parent to put me and my two sisters through Boston University. 2 days before I passed away, my mother died of a stroke. Every one of my clients is my mother. It's called giving your feelings directions. What's going on with this? What's going on with all of you with this Pence thing? What's all these awards? Well, I think I have an idea. See, first of all, I want to serve people. I want to be a blessing. And that's this whole fabulous firm. But can I tell you the wonderful thing about duct tape? When you remove it, you could tell it's been there. That's what kindness is. That's what service is. When you remove it, you could tell it's still been there. When the Pences come away, you could tell they've still been there because there's kindness. Why did that woman push? I know one thing about the great ones. Everybody's family. That's my brother. That's my sister. How do I serve them? So I have one last phrase I'm going to give you I use all the time. I'm not looking for blessings to come into my life. That's why I came all this way to do this talk, because I know the motto of Pence Financial. I'm not looking for blessings to come into my life. I'm looking to be a blessing in somebody's life. You know, when you speak something, you see it. I'm coming to the airport in Tampa, Florida, going, I'm looking to be a blessing in somebody's life. I see a woman standing at the Southwest counter, looked like she combed her hair with a lollipop. I walk up to her, says, ma'am, I think I'm looking for you. That line never worked. She said, my daughter's just blown up in a Humvee in Afghanistan. A life flight hurt her Carmel, Indiana, St. Vincent Hospital. She was a medic in the Army. They told me I came here to start screaming. I want to see my daughter. I said, where's your car? Where's your suitcase? I don't have one. You got me. And we got her there. I said, how's your daughter? She said, she squeezed my hand. Her femurs are broke. Her body's burnt, but we're going to get her there. We're going to get her to where she needs to go. You know why I saw her? I was speaking it. Today's talk simple. It's real simple. First thing, there's three things I want you to keep on doing to rewire your brain. Here's the first one. Come on, do this with me. Come on. Just keep chopping. The next one, say, so what, now what? Come on. And the last one, I'm not looking for blessings to come into my life. Come on. I'm looking to be a blessing in somebody's life. Now, every time I leave, I have a flight. I got to get out the airport because I'm going straight to New York City. But every time I leave during my whole career, I silently have been singing a song to myself. But lately, I make my crowds sing it to me. It's called Country Roads Take Me Home. And incidentally, when I was the International Olympic Committee, the Japanese Olympic Committee tried to sing it to me. That didn't go too good. So on three, I'm gonna count you in, but we're gonna sing. Ready? One, two, three, come on. Country roads, take me home to the place. Here comes the best part. You gotta sing this part. I loved you guys. Both of you guys, you know how much I love you both. I'd do anything for you. I love being with you. You are a great crowd. You are worth the trip. I need to close this talk and get off to New York. And I close all my talks with something my father used to say to my mother every time she left for the beauty shop. Best of luck to you. May God's blessing and favor be on every one of you. God bless.
Thank you, Dr. Elko. Now, I'm just a little worried about the cough drops I took, so if you see me running, you know what happened. I'm Robert Mustafa, for those that do not know me, financial advisor here at Pence Wealth Management. There was a handsome picture of myself on the wall that was supposed to be there, but maybe it will come. Prettier version here. In the early part of the decade, I was serving as a U.S. Army captain as an intelligence officer focused on economic analysis in the Middle East and North Africa. Our team was commanded by a charismatic lieutenant colonel who was in charge of reporting and analyzing economic turmoil during the Arab uprising. Those efforts were reported directly to the legendary Marine General Jim Mad Dog Mattis, who at the time was the head of U.S. Central Command to later become the Defense Secretary under President Donald Trump. This is how I got to know the next speaker. Many of you know him, but for those new to the organization, let me give you a little background. He serves as the Chief Investment Officer of Pence Wealth Management and oversees over $2 billion in assets under advisement. He earned his economics degree from Harvard University. He received his Army commission as a military intelligence officer from MIT. And if that was not enough, he received his certified portfolio manager designation from Columbia University. He combines his formal training and knowledge as an economist with years of experience in psychological warfare to bring a unique understanding of human behavior and how it affects the economy and the markets. In July of 2015, he retired from the Army Reserves as a full-bird colonel. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Colonel Dryden Pence.
Thank you very much, Robert. I appreciate being here. Let's give Dr. Elko another big hand. That was a lot of fun. So thank you very much. Well, you know, Robert mentioned a little bit about the fact that I've got a background in psychological warfare. This is why sometimes they put me on TV when the market's going down 500 points in one day, so that Liz Klayman or other people can talk with me about why is it doing this and what's going on. And so sometimes I'm on CNBC, sometimes I'm on CNN, sometimes I'm on Fox. I think I'm the only guy that both Fox and CNN will have on in the same week. Usually you're radioactive to the other if you've been on one of them. But the important thing is we're gonna talk today a little bit about human behavior and how it affects markets and everything we're doing. Dr. Elko has talked to you about resiliency. Layla's talked to you about taxes. That affects everybody's behavior. Who gets affected by taxes? Okay. I'm gonna talk about things economically and markets and stuff like that. Everybody's gotta repeat after me. Past performance is no guarantee of future returns. All right, perfect. Now we've all said the oath, right? That's the important thing. We're going to talk about resiliency. That's the theme today. And Dr. Elko talked about it, but I'm going to take this a little deep and give examples of resiliency and how it affects not only human behavior, but markets and what we do for the future. You see, let's think back. What was the last time prior to COVID? What was the last time everything stopped? We all remember that image of the planes hitting in 9/11. It's seared into your mind. Well, right after that, all of air traffic in the country was stopped, force grounded, right? And then everybody was terrified. That's what terrorists want you to be, is terrified. So we stopped transportation. But you know what happened in the United States of America is people got back to doing what they do. Human beings get back to doing what they do. We frequently continue to do the same things, we just do them differently. And you could see after a period of time here, after about 17 months, what did we do? Well, airline passenger miles and travel and TSA entrances got back to about where they were. I call it the half-life of misery. You only put up with it for about 18 months, and then you decide, I'm going to go ahead and go do it anyway. Right? Well, guess what? You don't think human patterns don't repeat. Watch this. Oh, my gosh. Here was COVID. Now, everybody was affected by COVID. I'll get into that in just a minute. But one thing that it did really quick is government came in and said, you're not flying. Right? And so we stopped it again. And then everybody that had to get back on a plane sort of did, but then it's taken us about 27 months to get back to where we were before. Now, has anybody flown lately? Were the planes empty or full? Full, exactly. Exactly. We're getting right back at it. So when you think about what I call the half-life of misery, it's about 18 to 27 months, and we get back to figuring out what we're doing. Last year at an event like this, half the people were masked and half of them weren't, and we used to have 450 people. Now we got 250 people and 250 on Zoom. Technology has adapted to that which we're doing. But human beings get back at it. And I want to remind those of you now, most of you have a coffee cup somewhere in your house that has this on it, right? And if you don't, just tell your advisor you want another coffee cup. We got plenty. All right? But this is are the principles that we follow. Principles are non-negotiable. They don't care what. By the way, principles are non-negotiable was something that was taught to me by a guy named Colonel Michael O'Kane when I was a young intelligence officer, when we were figuring out how to be covert operations intelligence officers. He said the first thing you got to remember is principles are non-negotiable. People don't care what you know until they know you care. If you fail to plan, you plan to fail, right? Human behavior drives consumption. That's the principle that we use for how we think about markets. I'll get to that a little bit later. And cash flow trumps volatility. Those are our investment principles. We've been doing this for a very long time. We've been doing this for over 30 years. Now, that means that I was a cradle robber when I married Laila. But because she is only 32 years old, but that's the important issue. But by the way, things repeat a little bit. You guys have seen this slide before because I used it in 2013 and 14 and 15 and 16 to talk about where we are flying through turbulence. Things are a little bumpy right now. Look. The first 6 months of this year in the markets have been the worst 6 months in the markets since just about everybody in this room became an economic adult. Now, when do you become an economic adult? You become an economic adult when you turn 30 or you have your first kid. That's when it happens, right? But we've had a rough 6 months. Okay. So what now what? We think through these things and we recognize that we go forward. One of the things to recognize is when I first got into this business, I was told a story by Fortune 100 CEO, one of my great mentors. He took me out. We're actually sitting on a fence looking at a herd of cattle in Arkansas. There are a few Fortune 100 companies in Arkansas, you know, J.B. Hunt, Walmart. You ever heard of that one? Right? So, so he's sitting there with me and he says, Dryden, what you got to know about the economy and markets is that God and nature are long. God and nature long. That means that in general, nature is designed for things to grow, things to go up. When you're long, that means you're positive and bullish. When you're short, that means you're negative and bearish. That's the way you talk about market parlance. He said, it's very, very simple. It's set up this way. You got a herd of cows out here. You put a bull with them. Sooner or later, you're going to get more cows. But that's the way our populations grow. Our population continues to grow. Our nation continues to grow. It creates additional economic activity, and that's a positive as we move forward. So I'm going to talk a little bit today, and I've got to go fast because Laila says you take too long to say anything. All the time. It's true. If you're married, you know what I'm talking about. But the point is, we're going to talk about past, present, future, and then I'm going to talk about when do things get better and what do we do about it in the process, right? That the when and the what. Let's get a little perspective. 2 years ago, unemployment was at 30%. The market had dropped 30%. It was massively uncomfortable. We're looking out in front of us, and it's dark, and it's gloomy, and no one knows what's happening, and our neighbors are a danger to us because they could give us a disease. Folks, everybody in this room and everybody on Zoom knows somebody who knows somebody. Who died as a result of COVID. We're still living with those effects. I mean, bottom line, if you're looking 200 years from now, when they look back at this period of time in our lives and as pure economic study, and they look at it and they go, in the world, 6 million people died and we spent trillions and trillions and trillions of dollars in recovery. You know what they'll say? Gosh, expected it or why. But that's what's happened. And that's what created things like this. Right? You remember those moments. It was ugly. It was ugly. But here you look at, you know, 6 months ago and you almost got the same thing. Now, in one case, we have a market that's down 30% because the economy is doing too bad. And in the other one, we are down, have a market that went down 30% because the economy was too good and inflation was taking off. Which one do you want? Which one has a better future? The one where the economy, where we basically are looking at inflation and we're looking at the Fed raising interest rate because the economy's too good, not because we're staring into abyss, nobody knows the answer and how long it's going to go on, and we have to pump $5.4 trillion into the economy. Look, policymakers made the best decision they could with the time and information that was available. Did they overstimulate the economy? Yes, they did. Are we living with the consequences of it? Yes, we are. But did they know perfectly what the results were going to be at the time when they did it? No, they did not. Everybody's made decisions like that. So now we just have to look forward. But the bottom line is we took $5.4 trillion, more money than we spent all entire period of time during World War II, and we dumped it in the economy in 1 year. It's going to have an effect. It's going to look like this. You take a big rock and you drop it in a pool of water, you get a great big splash, and then what else do you get? A ripple, and then a ripple, and then a ripple, and a ripple. But guess what happens to those ripples? Every one of them is smaller. And pretty soon, it all smooths out. It all gets back to normal. The water settles down, and it's a smooth pond. So today I'm going to spend a little time talking about ripples. Things that have happened, we can't change them, but we can think about how we deal with the effects thereof. Right now, where we are in this inflation mode that we're in that's affecting us, we're on that first big wave. We're on the riding that first big wave of the ripple. But it'll dissipate. Look what happened. That black line is the market went down and then back up. Down 30, came back up 126 in 126 days. The fastest dip and recovery in recorded history. These are all the fastest recoveries following a bear market. Look where we are right now. We're at day 144. The point of the matter is we're almost riding the second fastest recovery from a bear market. It's a ripple. So the thing to recognize that as we go through this, we're gonna be living through this. But as we go through this, you're just going to have to look at time after time after time. Here's what people are really afraid of. This is not where we are. Remember this? Anybody remember 2009? Anybody want to forget 2009? Okay, now we got consensus. But that massively difference, we didn't go down 25%, we went down 50%. Why did we go? We had a major structural flaw in the economy. We had a housing and banking crisis. What we're going through right now isn't that. Completely different set of reasons. Completely different set of reasons. And by the way, as bad and awful as that was, 33 months later, we were back to whole. Comfortable. Why does it matter? Why are markets so volatile? It feels like these changes are bigger than they used to be, doesn't it? And a little more uncomfortable as things are happening. So why are markets so volatile? I got the answer for you. Us. The human beings. We are the ones who are made. I have a question for you. Do you know any irrational people? Don't look at them. Don't look at them. Right? Are you perfectly rational? No. We're human beings. We have emotions. Emotions make us human. We have things like fear. You had children. You've been here, right? You've been here. You know what's going on. The fear of pain is frequently worse than the pain itself. The fear and anticipation of pain makes you react far more than sometimes the pain itself. We know the shot's going to be over. She's going to be okay. Well, what happens in the markets is the same thing. We have had 9 major corrections in the market since 2015. Yet these feel a little crazier. And guess what? They are. Right? Why is that? What has changed? Well, can we all agree that people are irrational, right? Okay, we've all done irrational things. Can I get an amen? All right, there you go. So here's what happened. Structurally, in what's going on, back in 2010, only about 10% of the trades in the market were being carried out by individuals with their own TD Ameritrade account or their Schwab account, getting on their own computer and doing their own thing. About 10% of the trades. Well, over time, as technology allowed more and more people to have access to the markets, that increased. It went to 14, then 15, 16%. By the time we got into 2020, 20% of the things going on in the market were individuals trading their own accounts. They weren't working with someone who had longer perspective of what's going on. We basically allowed to, and you can see this 24%, those were those meme stocks when everybody's going crazy, right? So what we've done is technology has, in effect, given sharp objects to the children. And then we gave them Red Bull. Okay? Because we messed all this stimulus that went out into the market. They didn't have anything else to spend it on. So what did they do? They poured it into the market, and they sat there emotionally and banged away at their trading, and they're still doing. Step away from the keyboard. Okay? Because what happens when you get at 10% irrationality is not moving algorithms. At 20%, it does. So you have irrational people taking the computers and making them irrational. And that's why you end up with a market that's like this. And this is why you have to step back and take 30, 40 years worth of experience and say, some of this just does not make sense, and we just need to step back and pay attention to it. Because what you don't want to do is go all in and all out, right? People will tell you, well, let's do a market timing service, and we're all in and all out. This is a fool's game. Statistically, you look at it, if you just stayed fully invested over the period of time of 30 years, you'd be up almost 10%. If you missed the 10 best days, you'd be down 12.9%. Getting it right is more than a 1 in 1,000 chance to get 10. You'd have to, your chances of getting it right 10 days specifically is 1 in 1,000. So what do we do in these moments? We got to remember that cash is an asset class. You're in, you're going to see more cash than you normally see. And you've seen that occur over the last 90 days. It's not like we're going all in or all out. But what we're doing is you're in an environment where you've got a bumpy road. Now, if you know if you drive really, really fast down a bumpy road, it gets really, really rough. So what do? You slow down. Okay? Because cash in a portfolio can be both a shock absorber during highly volatile moments, and then dry powder when you see things getting better. So if you look at your account, yes, you have more cash. Don't be afraid of it. Don't be afraid of it. It's us trying to do our job. We're trying to make sure we protect your assets. We'll take a little money off the table, act as a shock absorber in this case, and then be ready to take advantage of the market as it moves forward. And now you go, why don't we just go into fixed income and put it all into bonds? It's because I don't like walking into buzzsaws. The bottom line is what people have forgotten, although the stock market went down dramatically, the bond market did too. The ag dropped 12%. Why? Because it's basic math. When interest rates go down, bond prices go up. When interest rates go up, bond prices go down. Ladies and gentlemen, which way are interest rates going? They're going up. That's why you have more cash in your portfolio as opposed to having a lot of fixed income. We're going to wait for some of this, these changes to occur, and then we'll take advantage of them. So the next question is, when does this quit being so crazy? So we talk about the when. There's 4 things going on in the world. We've got an invasion, we've got inflation, we've got interest rates, and we've got an election. Those are the 4 big things that are happening. And you got to think about the dialogue. Dr. Elko talked about how you talk about it. Well, let's talk about the words you want to listen for other people. The invasion, we got to think about peace. Is there going to be peace in Ukraine because it frees up supply chains? Inflation, did we hit the peak inflation? Because once we've hit peak, what happens next? It begins to go down, right? It begins to go down, and that affects interest rates. Because once inflation starts going down, the Fed, is less likely to push them up, right? They'll stop raising interest rates. And ladies and gentlemen, the reason why the market's reacting like it is because interest rates are going up. It's very simple, right? And then the last one is the election. The election comes in November 8th. And then they think there's going to be changes in the government. You might see a Republican House. And if you do, typically the market does better in a divided government. So here's the problem. We only know the date of one of these. It's probably going to take 2 to 3 of these events to occur to see things get a little better, to get further out on the ripples and the pond kind of levels off. So we know one we have a date on. The rest of them are driven by circumstance. So let's talk about those circumstances, because this is about when does it get better. Let's talk first then about Ukraine. This is a horrible situation. It is a war. Russia can call it whatever they like, but it's a war. And it's awful. There's good news and there's bad news. There's good news and there's bad news. Everybody thought this thing was going to be over in 3 days. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I spend a lot of time as an intel officer and things. I can tell you that we have always overestimated the Russian army. And so has the Russian army. They did not expect the Ukrainians to say no. It's a beautiful thing. But the point is that Ukrainian soldier is holding in his hand a Javelin missile, and the T-72 tank cost $3.2 million. The Javelin missile cost $175,000. I like the math. Okay, we've been able to supply those to the Ukrainians, and that is why they were able to defend Kyiv. But this thing's not over. When you think about when does peace happen, it begins to happen when you see the Ukrainians maybe be able to have a combined arms counterattack, and they take back Kherson and things like that. Maybe that's when they'll begin to think about having some sort of settlement. But until then, it's going to be a lot of this. Now, one good thing that's going on, because this thing just grinds. It's a horrible thing. Russians just use a lot of artillery and it just grinds things into rubble. But one good thing that's happening is they are beginning to get long-range multiple rocket launcher artillery that is really making a difference. And I'll show you this, and I'll also show you the sweetest sound I've ever heard in my life. This is the HIMARS multiple rocket launchers taking off, which allows the Ukrainians to engage the Russian artillery and destroy it. And the reason why I really like one of these things is something like this saved my life in Iraq years ago. We were getting just really attacked badly, and we were stuck in an artillery barrage, and about 500-600 yards away, a multiple rocket launcher from a bunch of guys from Fort Sill, Oklahoma, lit it up. And that sound of those things going off is the sweetest thing I ever heard, because if they hadn't been there, I'd be dead. So what I really want to do is take a second to thank you for paying for that, because you should be proud. As American taxpayers, because what you're doing is allowing this nation to have a chance, to have a chance. So be proud of yourselves. Now, why does all this matter? The Ukrainian situation matters because it, in effect, took 3 million barrels of oil off the market, which we have to get that back. The Saudis can help some, but you can be proud of the United States. In spite of whatever else is going on, we've increased our production 400 barrels a day. That's important. And you're beginning to see oil prices come down. We have the capacity to actually increase about another 1 million barrels a day. That's going to be important. But oil prices coming down and going to solve all of our problems, because we lost a bunch of our refineries during COVID. They're not going to come back. EPA is not going to permit them. So what can you look forward to in gas prices? They're coming down a little bit. We've had 45, 46 days of lower gas prices. That's good. But when we get on the other side of this, we're still going to be looking at this, right? It's going to be a bit higher. It's going to be higher for a while. Actually, I used this slide in 2007, so you see how things come back around. But let's talk about human behavior. You can see from this slide, once gasoline prices get north of around $4, right, it comes back down because behavior changes. We see demand destruction. You know, 2 years ago, did you think about how much gasoline cost? Eh, not really. Do you now? You bet you do. You bet you do. And this happened all across the country. So as prices hit a certain, it's called price elasticity of demand. As you hit a certain price, it begins to affect your behavior. Probably 1 to 9 months, because our production has to catch up and global production has to catch up with what's going on. But let's talk about inflation expectations. Right. So right now, inflation is high and the Fed's raising interest rates because they got to knock it down. Right now, most people are expecting inflation to settle in around 3, somewhere in there. But right now, that's for the next 5 to 10 years. But right now, people are looking at 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Right. So we think that the consumers are expecting inflation to be fairly high for the next year or two. And then it's going to kind of go back down. And this is what caused the market to be so ugly in June. We got a bad print, right? It looks like it 9.1%. That is high. That's high. No matter how old you are, that is high. Okay? And the big question is, when does it peak? Because when it peaks, it begins to come down. So you're going to get a new inflation number on Monday. So pay close attention. If it's below 9.1%, then people will be going, oh, maybe inflation peaked in June, maybe July, maybe August. That's the thing to pay attention to. That's the thing to pay attention to. And why is that important? Well, about a third of the inflation is energy. So if we see oil go down, so this is why I feel a little bit better that we'll probably have seen our peak inflation number. It'll come back with probably June, July, or August. One of these three will have been where the peak occurs. Oil's coming down. Now, core inflation is going to continue to go up because shelter is gone up, right? How many of you have looked at rents or mortgages, right? So shelter cost is going up. That's part of core. But oil and energy is coming down. The other thing that's good in this case is you've seen me show this slide before. How many of you listen to our podcast? Okay. How many see the videos that I do afterwards? Okay. Very good. So you've seen this slide before. And the point of the matter is that the supply chain is getting better. It's not fixed, but it's getting better. So the big question is inflation, how high for how long? Well, we think it's going to be probably over 4% at least through 2023. Now let's talk about expected rate paths of interest rates. So I got to speed up here. Layla's already telling me I'm taking too long, right? They'll bring the food, folks. They really will. They're going to put the salads down at 12 noon, whether I'm on stage or off. So everybody just get on with it, right? So here's the thing. When we got a bad, difficult, and everybody was expecting a very high moment on interest rates to terminal rate of about 3.2, and then the market really fell down. As it looks like, man, maybe they won't raise it quite as high. You can see the market go back up, right? So basically, the longer they think interest rates are going to be higher, right, and the higher the terminal rate, that means when do they stop raising it, that's going to affect the stock market. If they think it's going to not be as high, or they think they're going to hit that pause button and stuff like that, the market will be positive. If they think it shifts, everybody thinks it shifts further to the right, that's going to be negative to the market, right? So we have to pay attention to that. But let's talk about what the upper bound is. Here's what everybody forgot. Right now, we're back up to around 250. We've been here before. We were here in 2019. Everybody forgot it. We had a period of time that the Fed raised the federal funds rate 9 times, 25 basis points, 9 times, and they shot it up to 250, right? That's where we were in 2019. Do you remember the stock market at the end of 2018? Was it up or down for that year? par, so they cut it 25 and then 50. They were lowering interest rates, and then COVID hit, right? So they just took it to zero because nobody knew what was going on. But what's important to recognize, when we were at where we are right now, the last time, that's when they stopped. Now, is that going to happen this time? Probably not. Why? Because they're trying to break the back of inflation, so they're probably going to raise it a bit more, a couple of more times. And here's the thing to recognize. You got to think about how they think about it. The average age of a member of the FOMC, the Federal Market Open Committee that sets these interest rates, is 62 years old. They remember 18% interest rates. How many of you do? Right? Of course you do. You remember 10% interest rate. You remember thinking doing business deals and 10% is okay. You got a home mortgage at 6%, and that was hallelujah. Right? Oh, by the way, question. How many of you drove here today in a car that cost more than your first house? Yeah, okay. There you go. That's inflation, right? You've lived through it before. But here's the issue. For the members of the Open Market Committee who are thinking about this, they're going, 6% home mortgages, so what? The problem is that millennials who are now 40% of the group of people that are out there buying homes, they've never known an interest rate. You tell them they got a mortgage north of 4%, their brains explode. I'm not going to do this. I can't do this. They've never seen it before. Now we've got more. And this is a behavioral thing. And you saw it again, going back to 18 and 19. We got home mortgages over 8%. Look at the blue line. It falls off. Demand falls completely off. Right? And you can take a look at it here. You read this stuff like a map. So what happens when you get moments when you've got a share of income north of 40% going to shelter? Demand is severely affected, and prices go back down. So we're in this conundrum. Where's the ripple? Right? Where does this come? When does it change? Well, we don't really know yet. Fed raised 75 basis points in July, and then maybe they're going to do 75, right, in September. We don't know. Could be 75, could be 50. We get a big number. On Monday, it's probably 75. We get that we think the peak is, it may be 50. We don't know. The point is, you're not going to really know what's happening until you get to September. We're just going to have to navigate through this rough spot. We're going to have to navigate through this rough spot. The other side of it is oil may be doing the Fed's job for them. Why does the Fed raise interest rates? To slow the economy down, to pull money out of the pocketbook. What's happening with oil? Oil prices have gone up still dramatically, right? And what are people? They're spending more money at the pump. You're either going to pay the oil companies or the bank, one of the two. But you're not going to be buying shoes. I mean, that's what happens. That's what happens. Big question everybody has is, no recession, little recession, big recession. We're kind of in the camp that it's either going to be no recession or a little recession. No recession or a little recession, or maybe a trough. And here's why. Here's why they're wanting it to slow down. The question is by how much. We think it's actually slowing down a lot faster than the Fed wants it to. As a matter of fact, because of this behavior thing's happening. So they're going to get the result at a lower level of Fed funds rate. It's just a period of adjusting to the ripples. And why do we think big recession's off the table? It's very simple. Folks, there are more people working today than there ever have been. Our employment is back to the peak it was before COVID. There are more people working today, making more money in this nation than ever before. Period, full stop. It doesn't matter what your politics are. That's significant and it's important. We've got two jobs for every person looking. So yes, what happens when the Fed tries to slow things down? Unemployment goes up. Well, unemployment does go up because jobs go away. Well, we could lose 5 million jobs and still be at 3.5% unemployment. We can't fill the jobs that got. This is why it's important. So it's very hard. When you look at savings rates, we still have a lot of excess cash saved in the markets. Now, there's large income inequality issues here, and I'll have to talk about that a separate time. I do not have time right now. But the bottom line here is it's hard to have a bad recession with low unemployment and reasonable balance sheets. It's kind of like this. We're driving a car at 90 miles an hour for several hours, and you probably, I've done that, some of you have. You drive a car for 90 miles an hour for several hours, and then you slow down to 50, and it feels like you're going really, really slow, almost at a dead stop. But you're still moving five times faster than you can walk. So what we're going to feel is a slowdown in the growth of the economy, which is exactly what they want. And if you look at earnings, which is the most important thing here, is the earnings then are in a position where they're actually recovering. We're looking at an increase in operating margins on the S&P 500. This is a positive trend, not a negative one. And actually, if you look at earnings, 75% of the companies beat earnings. Very important. Remember the price of stock. It's earnings times the multiple equals price. What do we think the market's going to do by the end of the year? There's where we are. You know the range fan is famous. You've been seeing it for a lot of times here. You know, obviously, we thought the lower part of this would be 13%. We went below that. We're not perfect, okay? But the point is, I think, if you want to ask me where it's going to be, we think that the market will be higher than it is right now at the end of the year. Don't necessarily think it'll be back to positive. And also think it's going to be rough getting there. Okay, so this little blurb we've had in July is wonderful and it feels good, but I don't think it's an all clear signal, right? We're going to have news and information. It's going to continue to be volatile and bounce around. You've got to remember, we're not going to get an all clear signal here. Nobody just rings the bell, but you got to pay close attention to peak, peace, pause, and patience. We need two or three of these things to have occurred before we think we're going to be having the ripples kind of go back out. And you talk about labor force participation. I mean, most people forget, gosh, where's all the workers? Well, quite frankly, we had 500,000 working age people die during COVID. Okay, which is very interesting. We lost about 500,000 working age soldiers in World War II. The parallels here are important to pay attention to because the ripples will continue to affect for a number of years. We can't change those, but we can try to be aware of them and look forward to how we have a better future, right? Here's the thing to recognize. This is resiliency. Human beings. Mobile themes. What are people doing? And you all are familiar with our term about choke point investing, right? What's a whole bunch of people going to do? We want to own that choke point. See, the big thing is I don't really care what's in these trucks. I just want my piece as they go through the toll road, right? We want to, because, hey, every time they go through the toll road, we get a piece of the profits, a piece of the earnings. So that's how we have to thematically stand in front of these big trends and pay attention to the fact that human behavior drives consumption. Nobody makes a penny until somebody decides to buy. And if we can get in front of the decision-making process, we can be predictive about not only what someone's going to buy, but who they're going to buy it from and when they're going to buy it. And how much they're going to pay. You see, we have to recognize that human beings really are the most adaptive species on the planet. We adapt and we overcome, no matter how big the ripple is. We adapt. That's why we're on the top of the food chain. And markets adapt. Companies adapt. All right, inflation's going to be over 4% throughout 2023. Most of the people in this room have lived in an environment that's been inflation over 4%. And you live there for an extended period of time. And it's okay. We have to get through the adjustments. Companies will adapt. Companies will be able to figure out how in an inflationary environment they can fix their markets and stuff and be able to do well. This is why we focus our investments in the areas of semiconductors. You realize that about 40% of a car is now semiconductors? About 40% of the cost of a car has something to do with semiconductors. That's why we think it's really important to own those things. Payment systems. All right, inflation goes up. Payment costs go up. Well, credit card companies get a piece of the price. What's going to happen to their earnings? Prices go up, earnings go up. You just change what you're investing in so that it is more resilient to the environment in which you're existing. We navigate through this stuff. We ride the ripples until they're leveled out. E-commerce. We increased e-commerce a lot during COVID, and people are still continuing to do it. The trend is continuing to grow, right? We pulled a lot of demand forward, but everybody figured out how simple it is. And oh, by the way, with gasoline prices up, what do? You shop online and you have it come to you, right? That's what people are doing. Financials. We like financials because net interest margins go up when interest rates go up. Defense. Is peace going to spontaneously break out anywhere? No. That javelin's $175,000 in every one of those rounds that went out from that HIMARS. Somebody paid Lockheed Martin $150,000 for. But they work. Railroads, when gas is north about, or oil is north about $75, $78 a barrel, a railroad's the cheapest way to move a ton mile of freight. And energy and mobility. This is not going to change. Are we going to decide that we're not going to have energy anymore? No. We're going to have to find better, more efficient ways of doing it. And the companies that have the technologies that do that are the ones that are going to get a lot of money, either from the government or from us or from both. Because it's very important. What is the cure for inflation? This is inflation over the last, since 1947. You can see the peaks that you see. Some of us in the room lived through the 77 versions, right? But what created this period of time where we were able to combat inflation significantly? We did it because we increased labor productivity. Labor productivity is the cure for inflation, more than anything else. And if you think about it, for every dollar of labor input that we put in, we're five times more efficient now than we were in 1947. Because we've used technology to make our factories more efficient. We used to be a huge manufacturing-based economy, and then we were able to use technology to make every person in the factory a lot more efficient. And that drove down prices over a long period of time, right? Walmart became efficient because they could control their supply chain, because in about 1982, they put a 386 computer in every cash register. And look at what happened. So the important point is, all of you know factories that were able to cut their employee count because they put in machines. So here's the big thing. Over the last 50 years, we've used technology to drive down the cost of manufacturing. Now we're going to do the point where we use technology to drive down the cost of service industries. We are the most adaptive, innovative group of people on the planet. That's the United States of America. That's why we have the strongest economy. That's why 330 million people in the United States produce more than the billion in China. We know how to do this. And now we're going to apply this technological innovation that we have to manufacturing to the service industry. Let me show you some examples. This is what's happening in our future, but it's also here.
Makes my life a lot easier. Autonomy will help because we will be able to put a tractor out in the field and let it run for 24 hours a day because it's not manned. But it also helps us with the weather because we can run so hard when soil conditions are fit.
We can run so hard when soil conditions are right or set. How effective could the company that you're involved with be if it could go 24/7 without interruption at exactly the right time. Massively more efficient. Massively more efficient, which would drive down costs and pricing, increase productivity and profits. The John Deere tractor. The last mile of delivery is the most expensive mile of delivery. What happens when these things become ubiquitous? When that last mile of delivery turns into not a driver, but a drone. And these things are able to be delivered to your home. Think of the cost and the efficiency that we're creating, that we're able to wring out of that delivery thing. That's where we're going to get productivity. That's where we're going to be able to drive down inflation in the markets. And there are more permanent changes that increase better lifestyles. Truck pull into a neighborhood and all these little drones are just going to take off from the roof of it. It'll be like an aircraft carrier. And then they'll all come back. Right? Last time I told you about how at McDonald's they had kiosks that you could go into and you could put in your order and pay right there in the kiosk, which would mean that your order would be right and your change would be correct because you weren't dealing with a person behind the counter. But what if they begin to take that technology and use it in the back of the store? Anything that can be repeated and specified can usually be done by a machine. And now something as simple as your French fries can be handled by a robot. But think of how much additional efficiency they have in that supply chain, which will allow them to draw down prices. Oh, by the way, everybody give a hand to the people here at the Marriott. These folks are working really, really hard. Really, really hard. We appreciate that. Thank you. Now, here's my favorite one. Something as simple as going to a bar. It's kind of entertaining. But you get your drink, and it's delivered to you. It's made correctly, and the bartender's not expecting a tip. Right? And service is probably faster. You don't have to wait in line, and there's not quite as much mundane conversation. Now, the last thing I want to talk to you about here is the metaverse. So the metaverse is, people have talked about, we own Facebook, we have it, and then Facebook said, we're going to take these tremendous profits that we're making from the thing that we did last time we were able to predict what everybody wanted, and we're going to pour it into what we think the future is going to be. By the way, yeah, the stock went down, but isn't that what you want a growth company to do, is to take the money that they have and invest it in what they think the next big thing is? That's what you pay them to do. So let's talk about what they mean by metaverse. This is astrophysicist Neil Tyson having a conversation with Mark Zuckerberg. And they're talking about, they're in two different parts of the country, but now you see them because they've basically put on a set of goggles that look like this. These are Oculus. And now they're actually side by side talking about the results of what they're seeing from the Webb telescope. Just think what that's going to do for science, innovation, business meetings, right? And the ability to be efficient. And we are only in the moments of what the flip phone version. We're at the very beginning of this technology. We've not made it to the smartphone version yet. I stole one of Layla's slides. She's a little mad at me about that. But the point of the matter is, so what is the metaverse going to be 10 years from now? What can we expect it to be? It'll probably be something like this.
Scott here.
You guys remember this?
Agreed to beam up, Mr. Scott.
Beam us up.
How many of you remember Star Trek? Absolutely. Now, no, we're not going to Orange County, either business or with family, at 10 a.m., conclude that at 11, and by 11:30, your avatar is in New York, right? Conducting business there in an interactive environment, right? This is where it's headed. I've often said science fiction kind of leads the way, right? You know, do you remember the Jetsons? Anybody remember the Jetsons? Okay, what was the name of the dog in the Jetsons? Astro. What did Amazon name their little doggy robot that they're selling today? Astro. It's amazing how these, somebody, some kid who watched the Jetsons growing up figured that one out. But let's talk about what the future's all about. These are the things we're looking at. I showed you pictures of what we're looking about this change in innovation over the next 5 to 10 years. But then what are we thinking about even beyond that? Artificial intelligence, autonomous driving, electric vehicles. You know, by probably about 2030, 2040, the majority of vehicles in the fleets of the auto production companies are going to be either hybrid or fully electric. Right, so solid-state batteries, big data, gene editing, CRISPR things, and how we're going to work in the medical fields, and nuclear power. All of these things are big, knowable themes in the future, and we want to be at those choke points and pay attention to them. So I've talked with you today about the past, the present, and the future. I've told you when we think things in the markets are going to be better and what we're going to do about it as we move forward. I hope that this has been informative. And I've hoped that it gives you an idea of where we are. Big rock goes into the economy. Now we're riding the ripples. Soon it'll be all smoothing out. And it's all going to be all right. We just have to keep moving forward. I told you where we think the market's going to be at the end of the year. It's going to be a little rough getting there. But folks, we've been doing this for a long time. We've been helping you walk through the minefields for a long time. And we're going to continue to do that. It is what we do every day, and we do it because we sincerely believe and appreciate so much the trust that each of you put in us. So first part of the year has been a little rough. Rest of it's probably going to be a little bit better. So we look forward to that. I really ask for you to take a few minutes to complete our survey for the clients and people that are guests. If you're online, please go ahead and make sure you fill out the survey because you're going to be in that raffle for the Amazon gift card. Let's see, going here. You also will get a link right afterward. And basically, mark your calendars today because next year, the client luncheon moves back to the spring. It's going to be our 26th annual client luncheon, and we'll probably have a contest for who's come to the most. You got to come in person. Who's come to the most over time. And it's going to be Saturday, April 29th, 2023. Ladies and gentlemen, for those of you here in the room, enjoy your lunch. For those of you on Zoom, thank you very much. We appreciate so very much everything you've done. We hope that this has been helpful. And enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you.
Just a your surveys, okay, if you complete them, please, we'll go around and pick them up. Also, that survey will be for the raffle. We're going to do about 30 raffles of gift cards between Amazon and gas cards and all that. But we also wanted to thank you for taking the time actually coming in person. Only the people in person actually get to this. We do have a little gift for you. It's going to be, it's a little pen and a opener and a envelope opener. Okay. And you will get these when you turn in your name badge at the end. Okay. When you turn your name badge where you actually checked in, make sure and get one of these. It's just a small thank you. It says, 25th anniversary. It's a little gift that we have for you. It's And I have to thank Emily for doing this. She's done a great job with this. I also want to thank my whole team here for doing this amazing. You guys don't know, this is like having a wedding every year. And I want to thank Emily and Dina and Alex and Milo and Ian and gosh, who, you know, Lana and Sabrina, the whole team. But really, it's an immense job that they do. We just get to show up and do this, but my team, I always say my biggest asset is my team, and that is so true. Our biggest asset is our team. So thank you so much. Enjoy your lunch.